أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم
صل على محمد وعلى محمد Respected brothers and my dear sisters السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته علامة الحلي We have heard this name quite a lot and we have a sheikh in London who uses the name Hilli our dear Sheikh Muhammad so sometimes when we hear his name we jump our minds jump to Allama but today we want to look at this great scholar and to learn some lessons from his life and to see the works which he did in order for us to get some lessons from the life of this great personality. In the introduction, his title which was given to him was Jamaluddin. Jamal ad-Din. This is not his name. This is a title. And for Arabs, like many other tribes, they are given titles. You can call it nickname. Jamal ad-Din. Jamaluddin. His name was Al-Hasan bin Yusuf bin Ali bin Al-Mutahhir Al-Hilli. Also, he was known as Allama Hilli. And I think the title also, Allama Hilli, is the title which, when we mention him, we think this is his name. But it is the title. And he was born on December 15th, year 1250 CE, and he died on the 18th, year 1325. He was a Shia theologian and mujtahid, meaning he was a marja taqlid. Like today we have Sayyid Sistani, Allama Hilli was a marja at his time. And one of the well-known Shia scholars of his time, both Sunnis and Shias, they knew Allama Hilli, they respected him as we are going to see. His debates with some Sunni scholars in Iran made the Sultan, the title, like a king, like in Oman, the head of the state of Oman is known as Sultan. The first one who was there, who passed recently, his name is Sultan Qaboos. May Allah have mercy on his soul. And now we have Sultan, is it Maitham?
Haitham.
Haitham. He's a current one. So in Iran, there was a Sultan who was the head of the country. And according to the debates which Allama Hilli had with some Sunni scholars, it made this Sultan and other people to follow the madhab of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. They became Shia Ithna Ashariya. And Allama Hilli was a Shia scholar of many sciences, including fiqh, jurisprudence, kalam, theology, and he authored more than 120 works or books, including these which are famous one, Kashful Murad, Nahjul Haq, Khulasatul Aqwal, and Jawharul Nadim, as we are going to mention them, insha'Allah ta'ala. Now, if you look at his name, he is known as Abu Mansur. He's not a name as well. This is because he had a son by the name Mansur. So if you have a son or a daughter, you will be known as the father of. Abu means father of. So he is known as Abu Mansur. Jamaluddin again is a title. Al-Hasan, his name. So Allama Hilli, his name is what? Al-Hasan, son of Yusuf ibn Mutahhar al-Hilli. He has written many books in almost every Islamic sciences, as we mentioned, jurisprudence, fiqh, principle of jurisprudence, usulul fiqh, theology, if you want to call it kalam, aqa'id, philosophy, logic, supplications, and many other sciences. Unfortunately, and this is a big unfortunate, most of his works are not translated into English. So if we want to read his books, we need to know Arabic. Maybe other books have been translated into Farsi and maybe Urdu. But the best thing is to read the works in the original language. Allama al-Hilli was very educated, and due to his vast knowledge, he was given the title Ayatullah when he was very young. Ayatullah, this is a compound noun or names. Ayatu Allah. Ayah, signs. Allah of Allah. So Ayatullah means a sign of Allah. Meaning, when you look at this particular individual, most of the time he's a scholar. He knows many things concerning Allah. He will take you back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why he is known as Ayatullah. So Abu Mansur Jamaluddin al-Hassan ibn Yusuf ibn Mutahhar al-Hilli, as we say in the English dates, in terms of Arabic, he was born in the year, in terms of Hijri calendar, in the year 648. And he was born in the month of Ramadan, and it was in this area of Al-Hilla, and he comes from the city of Hilla. When we hear Al-Hilli, this is an attribute referring to people from the city of Al-Hilla in Iraq. The city turned into the center of Shia scholarship in the 5th century, Islamic century. Many prominent Shia scholars were from this city. And in the 7th century, Hilla took the place of Najaf. Can you imagine the Najaf we know today? In the 7th century, Hilla was that Najaf of that time. And many scholarly families such as Al-Bitriq, Al-Nama, Al-Tawus, Al-Mutahhar, they came from this particular area of Hilla. So when you go for Ziyara and you go around, you can see some signs which point towards Hilla. That is where he came from. When you look at his studies, he was very young when he began his education under the supervision of his father, Sheikh, who was his father. And he began his education, as we say, under the father who was known as Sheikh Yusuf bin Al-Mutahhar. Now, he studied the key Islamic studies from early age. After being taught introductory subjects and Arabic grammar, he studied jurisprudence. Let's pause here. You look at Allama Hilli and many other scholars, these studies which are to introduce someone, mainly are Arabic grammar, recitation of books in Arabic, including Quran, Ahadith, just to recite them. And this is very important. If we want our children to become, inshallah, scholars in the future, we need to make sure they know these principal subjects, which are Arabic plus grammar, and the grammar itself is divided into two. You have Nahaw and Sarf. We need to make sure they know. If you give them a book, they read. It's very important. Quran, as we said, it's a key, it's principle. If you go to Hausa to study today, they won't teach you Quran. Why? Because they expect you to know Quran before you go there. So no tajweed, no ahkamu tajweed, forget about that. You have to know them before you join. It's like going to university and then you want to learn the studies of primary school. They will not teach you there. So Allama Hilli finished his early studies from his father. And then after that he started learning jurisprudence, science of hadith, theology, under his father, also under his uncle, who was known as Muhaqqiq al-Hilli. The title Muhaqqiq is the one who does research. You give him something, he says, well, let me find out more information about this. Let me do research. Until he becomes muhakkik. He can't just take something for granted. Later, Allama Hill studied logics, philosophy, astronomy, and other scholars, particularly Nasiruddin At-Tusi. He taught him that. When we mention things like astronomy, the way they used to call it, ilmul falak, it's a subject which most of our scholars used to know. And it has got many branches. So our scholars did not only study what we know today as Hausa studies, dry subjects for some people, which are so sweet for our scholars, but they studied many other lessons. Some of his teachers, Sheikh Yusuf Al-Hilli, who was his father, Al-Muhaqqiq Al-Hilli, Sayyid Radhi Ad-Din Ali bin Tawus, Sayyid Ahmad bin Tawus, Nasiruddin Tusi, Yahya bin Sa'id Al-Hilli, Kamil Ad-Din Maitham bin Ali bin Maitham Al-Bahrani, grandson of one very famous scholar, Maitham Al-Bahrani, Burhanuddin Al-Nasafi, he studied under these great scholars. So now, when we look at the title Ayatullah, some people, when they pronounce, they say Ayatullah. Others say Ayatollah. It's not a big issue. But for us, because this title comes from Arabic language, we prefer to call it Ayatu. Ayatullah. And not Ayatollah. Because in Arabic, you don't have A. So you have U. A-E-U. Alif Fatha, Alif Kasra, Alif Dhamma. A-E-U. Ba fatha ba kasra ba dhumma ba bi bu. We don't have A or O. So don't say ayato, say ayatu. But maybe sometimes we don't pay attention and we use the way other people use. However, since Al-Hilli reached the level of ijtihad before what time? Before attaining maturity. Allahu Akbar. How can you become a mujtahid? Let's say before the age of 18. It's not easy. It's tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one. And number two, parents work so hard. Also other teachers work so hard. He became a mujtahid before the age of maturity and achieved many merits at a very young age. When we say a mujtahid, it means that you know at least 500 verses from the Holy Quran. These 500 verses talk only about Islamic law. Islamic law means fasting, hajj, zakah, khums, marriage, talaq, mirath, inheritance, and many other things. There are 500 verses. You need to know whether they are abrogating or abrogated, whether they are general or specific. Whether, all the discussions about tafsir, it's not easy for a young person to know all these at the young age. But Allama Hilli was gifted, so he became a mujtahid, not only understanding these verses from the Holy Quran, but also a hadith. This hadith is sahih, this hadith is authentic, that one is not. For a young person to know all these sciences at this age, it's not easy. And that's why his family and scholarly circles within the Hausa, they call him Jamaluddin. What does Jamaluddin mean? The beauty of religion. You look at this young man, you see that he has brought beauty, or beautiful things within religion. After the demise of the Shia Marja al-Muhaqqiq al-Hilli in the year 676 AH, his students and other scholars from Hilla chose Allama Hilli to become their marja. They say, you will have to become a marja. And he was at the ripe young age of 28. Can you imagine, yeah? A young marja, taqlid. When we look at the sur pictures nowadays, yeah? These are photos of our maraji, they're old people. Sayyid Sistani, very old. Sayyid Bashir Najaf, Sheikh Bashir, old. Ishaq Najafi, old. Sayyid Hakim, old. Sayyid Ali Khamenei, middle age, old maybe, and many others. 28? You become a mujtahid, a marja? It's something which is very rare, but it's possible. Why? When you prepare the ground. When you look at the discussion about scholars, what do they say about him? You will find that Sunnis and Shia, they have mentioned few good things about him. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, this is a Sunni scholar, regards al-Mahili, says he was Aya fil Dhaka. Ayatun fil Dhaka means he was a sign of intelligence. This is a Sunni scholar, mentions al-Mahili like that. Sharafuddin al-Shulistani, Sheikh Bahai, Alam al-Majlisi, in various certificates for their students, they mention al-Mahili with the title Ayatullah fil Alameen, the sign of Allah in the worlds. Not just Ayatullah, fil Alameen. Because why? He was so knowledgeable, al-Mahili. Some of his students, you look at Fakhrul Muhakkikin, who was his son. Sayyid Diyahuddin Abdullah al-Hussein al-Hilli, his nephew, was a student. Sayyid Hamid Abdul Muttalib, his nephew, again student. Radhi Din Ali bin Ahmad al-Hilli, Qutubuddin al-Radhi, Muhammad bin Ali al-Jurjani, all these famous scholars were his students. Now, there is this well-known debate, which if you look at the books like Raihanatul Adab, in Sharh Man La Yahdhuru Al-Faqih, Mirza Muhammad Ali Al-Mudarrisi Al-Tabrizi quotes Alama Al-Majlisi in that book, Raihanatul Adab. He says, one day the Sultan or King Al-Jaitu, his name, before he became Muhammad, he was from Mongols. As we understand, these Mongols, they were fighters. Mongols, they used to raid other countries, occupy them, stay there. They ransacked Baghdad a few times and they became leaders there. They were not Muslims, but they were good fighters, Mongols. They come, they occupy the place, and they stay there. Funny enough, we use the word funny for the sake of understanding. When they entered Baghdad, most of these Mongols who are non-Muslims, they accepted the religion of those they invaded. Imagine any country, for example, now in the Western, it goes invades any other country in the East. Because of the akhlaq of people and knowledge, they become Muslims. And we have had some stories, for example, at the time of George Bush, the second, or the son, when America invaded Iraq, some soldiers who went there, they became Muslims. It happens sometimes. Why? For many other reasons. Here, this Sultan wasn't a Muslim, and later on he became a Muslim following Madhabah Ahlul Sunnah. He held a meeting, he gathered Sunni scholars and invited Alama Hili to the meeting. When Alama Hili entered the meeting, he put his shoes under his arms. Yeah, you see a scholar putting the shoes under the arms. It's something which people are saying, what is this? When he was asked why he did not, number one, he put his shoes under his arms, and when he entered, he didn't bow to the king. He just said, Salamu alaikum. And this, for some people, it was like, it's not the etiquette of anyone when you enter to the king. You don't bow. You have to bow to show the respect. Alama didn't do that. And he sat beside the king. So when he was asked why he did not prostrate for the king, he replied, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was the king of kings. And people, why didn't you prostrate or bow for the king? He said that people said salam to him. And the Quranic verses is very clear. When you enter houses, greet your people with a salutation from Allah, blessed and good. So, Quran says, say salam. Rasulullah sahaba used to say salam. They didn't do something more than that. And when he was asked, and he said again, all of us agree that prostration should be specifically done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was then asked why he sat beside the king. He replied, it was the only empty place I saw. And there is a hadith from the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. according to which when one enters a meeting, one should sit wherever he finds empty place. Yeah? When you find an empty place, you sit. Sometimes, I know, when we go masjid or other places, we want to jump on the necks of the people in order for us to sit somewhere. Alhamdulillah, in our majalis, at least you say, please move, come forward, that's good. So he said, this is the akhlaq of Rasulullah. They asked him, what was the value of the shoes that made you bring it with yourself inside the king's meeting? You are supposed to put the shoes outside. Why you brought the shoes with you? He replied, I fear that Hanafis steal them, as their head stole the shoes of Prophet Abu Hanifa. The Hanafis who were there objected that Abu Hanifa did not live at the time of the Holy Prophet. Say, what are you talking about? Abu Hanifa was not at the time of the Holy Prophet. So he didn't steal the shoes. Allama Hili said, oh, sorry, I forgot. I think the one who stole the Prophet's shoes was a Shafi. What would the Shafi say? No, Imam Shafi was not at the time of the Holy Prophet. He was then asked, and it continued. Maybe Maliki, maybe. So he made them to laugh. And they said, ho, ho, ho. Is this the scholar? He was brought from Iraq to come here to discuss about the fiqh masail. He doesn't know even history. That Shafi was not at the time of Prophet. Abu Hanifa was not. Maliki was not. Hanbali was not. He kept quiet. He then was asked, why did he... we have mentioned that. So, eventually, the same dialogue recurred about Shafi, Maliki and Hanbali. Alama said to the king, now it turns out that none of the heads of four schools or al-Madahib al-Arba lived in the period of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So this is what he wanted to prove. Oh king, have you heard them? Hanafi, Hanbali, Maliki, Shafi, they said themselves, their leaders were not at the time of the Holy Prophet. Oh, they were like shocked. We didn't know that he will use this tactic. And then he said, but the Shias follow Amirul Mu'mineen Ali alayhi salam, who was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam wasi and brother as well as his soul. Allama went on to deliver an eloquent lecture. At the end of the debate, the king converted to the madhab of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wa sallam. And it was this debate which made him to follow Imam Ali as the rightful successor after the Holy Prophet and became a Shia. He then changed his name from Al-Jaitu to Muhammad Khudabanda or Khudabande, according to Farsi language. Muhammad was his name. Khudabande, the servant of God, the hand of God, meaning the one who gives service for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you look at some sources in Islamic history, they say the debate was about a divorce. This king, because he was a Sunni, he married a woman, he loved this woman, but problems happened, he divorced him. How many times? Three times. As our Sunni brothers, they say, when you divorce your wife, you say, Anti Talik, Talik, Talik. You are divorced, you are divorced, you are divorced. If you say three times, it means that these are three talaq. What does it mean? She cannot be married by you again. Unless she stays in a period of iddah, waiting period, how long? 3 months and 10 days. And then, after finishing these 3 months and 10 days, another man should marry him. Should marry her, sleep with her, and then when he divorced her, then after iddah you can marry her. You get my point? These are three talaq in one city. According to our Sunni brothers, it's fine. Where is their evidence? They say that according to the Holy Quran, ayah number 129, if I'm not wrong, Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 129. Can we have a look at ayah 129, Surah Al-Baqarah? and see, no, 229. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. At-talaqu marratani fa imsakun bima'rufin aw tasrihun bi ihsan. Until the end of the ayah. Divorce must be pronounced according to Sunni tafsir, like the one I have here. It says divorce must be pronounced twice, and then woman must be retained in honor or released in kindness until the end of the ayah. If you read this English, which I have, then this is not according to the madhab of Ahlul Bayt. Why? Because it says divorce must be pronounced twice. If you pronounce three times, she will be divorced three talaqat. And then you are haram to return to her until she stays for iddah and someone else marries her. Ahlul Bayt alayhim wasalam, they say, At-talaqu marratani. Talaq is marra. Marra, times. Not pronunciation of it three times. If you divorce your wife, you go back to her. You divorce her again, you go back to her. You divorce her again three times, then you cannot return to her, or she cannot return to you, until she stays after Idda. She is married by another person, he divorced her, and then after the second Idda, you can go and marry her. You know what is happening in UK nowadays? There are some people, I can't call them scholars, from Sunni school. Even one newspaper, I forgot the name, whether it was Independent or Times, if you Google it, you can see it, that there are some of these who are known as Muhallil. Muhallil is the person who makes the... When you, for example, divorce your wife three times, they can come and say, okay, we will marry your wife, but give us some money, because we don't want to marry her. Give us money, we take the money, and we'll sleep with her, and then we'll divorce her, and then she can go to Idda, and then you can go back to her. Newspaper in UK have written this story, but it is a Sunni understanding. For Shia, that is not acceptable. If you divorce your wife three times, not by saying three times, and unfortunately, even some documentaries have been made here to show that some sisters in some communities, they suffer because a husband comes home and the husband is hungry. You are divorced three times, go home, and she can come back again. According to Madhab of Ahlul Bayt, no, this ayah is our evidence. At-talaqu marratani. Marratan. It should be, you divorce her three times, and then you cannot go back to her until she is married by another man. If you want to refer these masail, refer to the fiqh books for you to see more than that. Coming back to Allama Hilli. When Allama Hilli was asked, what is your opinion about my wife because I have divorced her? Allama Hilli said, you can return to her. Why? While all these scholars, they have said no. Allama Hilli said to the king, but they said they were not at the time of the Holy Prophet. Their leaders were not there. So if Shafi, Hanafi, Maliki, Hanbali were not at the time of the Holy Prophet, how can they give fatwa better than the one who was at the time of the Holy Prophet? And Imam Amirul Mu'minin is my Imam, and he was with Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And of course, the king was very happy, and he said, Alhamdulillah, mashallah, alhamdulillah, I wanted my wife so I can go back. I want your fiqh, come teach us more. Teach people about this madhab of Ahlul Bayt. And that's how it spread in Iran at that time. Let me say one point which is very important. There were many faces, levels of tabligh in Iran, which made people to become Shias. Allama Hilli was one of those series of tabligh by Shia scholars. Some of his works, Sayyid Muhsin al-Amini writes in his A'yan al-Shia. Allama Hilli wrote more than 100 books. And he says, Sayyid Mohsin al-Amin, he says, I have seen 95 of his book, many of which are in numerous volumes. He also wrote that in the book Ar-Rawda, Allama writings are said to be over 1,000 research works. Mirza Muhammad al-Mudarrisi mentioned more than 120 works in his book Raihanatul Adab. And when you look at some of the well-known works of Allama al-Hilli, this includes Mukhtalafu al-Shi'a and Tadhkiratul Fuqaha. These are concerning jurisprudence. If you know Masail, our scholars have different opinions. Mukhtalafu al-Shi'a, you can find in it different opinions regarding Masail Fiqhiyya. Kashful Murad, Babul Hadi Ashar, and Minhajul Karama, they are about Aqaid, theology. Today, if you go to any Hawza Islamiyya, any Hawza including the Hawza Ilmiyya here in London, you can see that Babu al-Hadi Ashara is taught. Why? Because it is the book of theology. Sheikh Hujjatul Islam wal-Muslimin, Sheikh Muhammad Ali Shomali, has got a series of these lectures on Babu al-Hadi Ashara. If you Google them, you can listen to them. They are very important, especially to do with Masail of Aqaid. We need to equip ourselves properly. And then there's another book which is known as Khulasa al-Aqwal. This is concerning Rijal, meaning biography of narrators of Hadith. He has written a book which is known as Khulasa al-Aqwal. There's a book which is Jawharun Nadid, we mentioned in the beginning. This is about logic, mantiq. And these books are very important up to today. Can you imagine, Allama Hilli lived in the 7th century. Or 6th, 7th century, up to today, his books are taught in the Hawza Ilmiya because of the work which he did. Allama also wrote two books concerning the principles of Shia beliefs, Aqaid, under the title Nahjul Haq wa Kashfu Sidq and Minhajul Karama, as we mentioned, and dedicated them to Sultan Al-Jaytu. He said, because you are a new follower of Madhab of Ahlul Bayt, you need something to read and understand, and he made it so. To my dear brothers and sisters who are new in the madhab of Ahlul Bayt, let me make this point. Look at Allama al-Hilli, what he did. He wrote the books and he gave it to Sultan. He said, you need to read. I have noticed some of the brothers and sisters who accept the madhab of Ahlul Bayt, they may accept the madhab because of aqaid issues. Imam Ali is wasi of Rasulullah, he is better than other companions, and because of his merits we follow him. And then we stop, we don't read more about akhlaq, we don't read more about the fiqh, and we don't read more about many masail. Until sometimes you become a Shia by new title, but your thinking is still the same madhab which you are. There's a danger there. You may mix things and you think that this is the madhab of Ahlul Bayt. We need to make sure we learn these masail properly the way Allama Hilli did. Now, Allama Hilli stayed in Iran until the death of Sultan Muhammad Khudabandi, and he propagated the madhab of Ahlul Bayt, he taught it, and he traveled with Sultan. He was given opportunity to teach, sometimes in a tent, the madrasa which was known as Madrasa to Sayyara, which is a movable, portable school. And he taught wherever he went. Until Sultan Khudabanda passed away, it was then Allama Hilli returned back to Iraq. Now, there's a discussion here scholars ask. Did Allama Hilli meet with Imam of our time, Al-Hujja ibn al-Hasan al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu farajahu al-Sharif? Now, according to Allama al-Majlisi, according to Allama Qadi Nurullah Shushtari, in his Majalis al-Mu'minin, the book Majalis al-Mu'minin, he mentioned that Allama Hilli met with Imam Sahib al-Zaman twice. Unfortunately, he did not cite any written source for the story. He didn't say, this, I've got it from this particular book. He said that the two stories were well known among the Shias. Di dalam akhir liso Imam Sahibul Zaman, Qadhi Nurullah Shushtari says yes. These are two well-known stories. Story number one, copying a manuscript. One night or one day, Imam Allama Hilli was given a book. And this book was given by someone from other madhab. Allama Hilli saw the book and he said, I want to write something about the commentary of this book. Borrow me the book. I'm going to copy the book and then I will return the book to you. He said, no problem, take it. But I give you only for one day and one night. And you have to return the book to me. Allama Hilli said, okay, I'll take it. He went home. He was busy teaching, giving fatwa and so on and so forth until night. The time was very short. Now he was thinking, how can I copy the book? I have only night and tomorrow I have to return it because this is amanat. It's a trust. So he fell asleep. While he was in his sleep, he saw Imam Sahibul Zaman alayhi salam. And the Imam came to him and he said, can I borrow this book and I will return it to you? He gave it to him and he went away. Before Fajr, he returned the books, two books. The book which is origin and the one, a copy, and he said, this copy is for you, Allama Hilli. So when he woke up, he saw two books. And he said, this cannot be by anyone except the one who came in my sleep was Imam of our time, Al-Hujjah bin Hassan al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu farajahu sharif. The second time, as is mentioned, according to Qadhi Nurullah Shushtari in his book Majalis al-Mu'mineen, he says that was when Allama al-Hilli was going for Arba'een of Imam Hussein. He was going to Karbala. While he was on his way, Allama was talking to other people who were there, and all of a sudden there was this traveler. Someone, Zahir, is going for ziyarah. He came to him and he said salam, and they were talking to him like any Zahir. And then he said, do you know the masail in the book of hadith? This hadith says this and that. Allama Hilli said, I'm not sure about this mas'ala. He said, no problem. When you go back, check this mas'ala. Why? Because Allama Hilli had questions and he wanted to ask someone who knows, but he didn't get chance. And then he started opening to this Zair stranger who is going for ziyara. And he said, I have this mas'ala. What is the explanation of it? And the person mentioned, the answer is this. The hukum is this, from the Quran, from the hadith of the Holy Prophet. He said, subhanallah. Then Allama Hilli said to him, will it possible for me to meet with the Imam of my time? At that time, he was holding something on his hand and it fell down. This person picked it up and he gave it to Allama Hilli and he put his hand on the hand of Allama Hilli. And he said, yes, it's possible for you to see him because he has placed his hand on your hand. And then he disappeared. According to people, they say that Allama Hilli believed that that was Imam of our time. Now, this takes us to another point. Is it possible for us to see Imam of our time or not? There are two opinions. One which says you can never meet with the Imam of your time before Zuhur. Until the time of Duhur, everyone sees Imam, you will be able to see him. And others believe that it is possible to see the, according to these stories. As I said there, Qadhi Nurullah Shushtari, he did not mention the source. He said in his book, Majalis al-Mu'mineen, these stories are very well known. They are famous, everyone knows. We leave it there. Allama al-Hilli passed away in the month of Muharram, 21st, in the year 726, which was year 1325, he was 78 years of age. He was buried in the shrine of Imam Ali alayhi salam in the city of Najaf al-Ashraf. I'm sure you have been at this particular haram of Imam Ali alayhi salam. When you enter the main entrance, you go, you say salam in the where the shrine, the qabr is. When you come out from their right side, then you come, if you want to come back again from this door, the grave of Ala Mahili, if you enter here, it is on the right side. Unfortunately, many people, when they go for the ziyar of Amirul Mu'mineen, this is Amirul Mu'mineen, their mind, their thinking, whatever is with Amirul Mu'mineen, and they miss to see the grave of Alama Al-Hilm. But he was gifted, Alhamdulillah, and he was made to be buried near Amirul Mu'mineen, and many other people who know when they go for the ziyarah, they read a lot of dua to Allama. These are some of the sources which I visited them or quoted from. At this point, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on the ruh of Allama al-Hilm. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him abundantly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to go for the ziyarah of Amirul Mu'mineen in Najaf. And so